Alhamdulillah. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you. Welcome to the Dean Show. With me on the Dean Show today, we got him back for another Q&A session. My good friend, good brother, Sheikh Yasser Kardi. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you. How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah. I'm doing fine.
All right. I thank you once again for being with
us.
Always
my pleasure, Eddie. Always
thank
my
you.
Pleasure.
Thank you so much. Jazakallah khairam. We invite you back to do another Q&A session. Mm-hmm. For those of you who know my good friend, good brother here, Sheikh Yasser Kardi. But for those of you who don't, we're going to take about 20, 30 seconds to let you know who he is. We'll be right back. ما رددت يا رب العباد وانتشت روحي وصار الدمع يجري يا إلهي خذ بقلبي للرشاد أشرقت نفسي بنور من فؤادي. All right, now you know that who the Sheikh is and where he studied, and that we don't, like I said before, have a car mechanic here giving us this nasiha advice, answers to these very important questions. We're going to get right down to it. I encourage you to keep your questions coming in. This way, it's a great way for all of us to learn, because we're sincerely trying to know the truth. And what better way? Asking those who are the most qualified, okay? So we're going to get right down to it, wasting no time. I'm going to ask you some questions, if you can, from
fire
what
away.
You guys are asking, okay? These aren't my questions. We're going to ask now, first question. What should I do about my prayer? What should I do about duhur, the afternoon prayer? Because at that time, I'm in school.
Okay, well, realize that every single prayer of the five prayers has a beginning and end time, obviously, as we all know. Therefore, you need to look at, firstly, are you going to get back home in time before the beginning of the next prayer, which is asr? Generally speaking, you know, I think that 95% of people, you know, children and teenagers and college level kids who go to school will be able to get back home before the beginning of the Asr prayer. So alhamdulillah, they should be fine there. If there is a certain special school or a certain area of the land where, you know, Asr prayer finishes before school finishes, in this case, really, you should try as a Muslim, you know, in your school, to ask the principal, ask the teacher, can I get 5 minutes off to pray dhuhr? And I don't think there should be a problem. Where there's a will, there's a way. If you can get time off to go to the bathroom for lunch, for this or that, surely they'll give you 5 minutes for your dhuhr prayer. So really, I think that if this is going to be a habitual thing, such as a dhuhr prayer of the year, I don't see any excuse to try to combine or to do anything like this. Rather, either pray it at home before Asr, or if it's going to be conflicting the prayer timings, then make sure you find a place and a locality. For example, people at work, generally when you're working, you go beyond Asr prayer. Therefore, find a place where you can pray, and in North America at least, you're constitutionally, you know, guaranteed the right to be able to pray no matter what your job is. You can take a few minutes off to go and pray and then come back, inshallah. So.
Okay, good answer to a very good question. Asking your questions here on the Dean Show. All right, next question. Is taking a loan from the bank for a house or car considered riba?
Okay, realize, brothers and sisters, that there is no difference of opinion at all amongst the scholars of Islam today that a mortgage is riba. There's no difference of opinion at all. The only difference comes, are we allowed and permitted to take this riba loan to buy the house that we live in or not? In other words, is there such a dire need to take this loan that it becomes permissible? Nobody says the loan is permissible from the beginning. Nobody says that this is an okay transaction. You see, the only difference is, does it become okay because you're in such a difficult circumstance? It's like when you're about to die and you have pig meat in front of you. Nobody says pig meat is allowed. But when you're about to die, then you're allowed to eat that pig because otherwise you're going to die. Okay, the issue is, according to the scholars, are we in such a difficult situation right now that it can be raised to that level where the haram becomes halal, where the prohibited becomes permissible? So some ulama, I would say a minority, have said that the situation in North America is so difficult, in Europe and other places we're in minority, the cost of housing is so high, it's astronomical. It takes, you know, 20, 30 years for a person to be able to, you know, slowly but surely pay that loan off to get a house, and you might as well be paying for the house. Some ulama have said, you know, may Allah forgive you, but just go and do it for the house you live in. Not for business, not for a car, for the house you live in. But having said that, that's a minority opinion, okay? I personally, you know, don't favor it too much, because the issue of interest is a very severe issue. And as I said, no two scholars have differed that a mortgage is riba, that a mortgage is interest. How can it not be when the bank says, I'll pay you 100,000, you pay me back 150,000 over 25 years? This is the essence of interest. That's exactly what interest is. So many people are confused and they say, oh, some ulama have said mortgages are halal. No, it's not that simple. Nobody has said a mortgage is halal unconditionally. Rather, what they're saying, some ulama, as I said, minority, mortgages are permitted for specific reasons and to specific people. Mortgage is haram, just like pig is haram. But it might become halal, according to those scholars, if you're living in North America and you have a difficult situation, you can't afford to rent for 20 years, and you just want to buy that one house you live in. They'll say, it's like that pig's meat in that situation, you can just do it for that situation. It doesn't become halal forever. It's just for that situation. You know, may Allah forgive you, and you have to do it. The majority of scholars, I would say, still say no. For most people, renting is a difficulty, but it's not impossible. If you rent, you know, year after year, sure, you're going to be, you know, losing, if you like, money, but it's still, you can still live reasonably. If one third of your income, for example, is going into rent, you still have two thirds for groceries and for the rest of your living expenses. So I personally would say that the general rule should be that no, you know, mortgages would not be permitted to the people, because it's clear-cut haram. It's like alcohol. It's like, you know, dead meat. It's like pig meat. It's in fact, to be honest, the prohibition of interest is more severe than the prohibition of dead meat, of fornication, of many of the sins in Islam. Because Allah says in the Quran that whoever takes or eats interest, it's as if he's declaring war against Allah and His Messenger. If you want to take or receive interest, you want to play around with interest, you might as well say, oh Allah, I am challenging you to a battle. A'udhu billah. Seek Allah's refuge from even saying that. But that's what the Quran says. To take the sin of interest lightly, really, the Quran and Sunnah is very clear. Interest is not just a major sin. It is one of the most major of all major sins. It's not just any trivial sin. It's a major sin, but not just any major sin. A major sin is like fornication. That's a major sin, problem. But interest is even a higher level than that. Therefore, for somebody to say, you know what, interest is permitted for all Muslims living in North America, I think that's, personally speaking, that's just my personal opinion, with all due respect to those who have said it, I think that's broadening it too much and making it a little bit too lax. Rather, I would say the general rule is that we should rent as much as possible.
And so, like you said, the riba, the interest today is the same riba that's talked about in the Quran.
No difference in opinion about that.
Okay. And wasn't it just a note on the side that it was actually prohibited in a lot of the countries, in this country and other countries, just how long ago? Wasn't that true?
Yeah, for I think up to, you know, the 17th, I'm not sure exactly, but it was since Christianity and Judaism also prohibits interest.
It does, right? Doesn't it?
Yeah, it does, yeah. Since it also prohibits interest, then this was something that even Western countries had prohibited for many, many centuries. It's only recently, I don't remember the exact date, but it's only the last 2-3 centuries where, you know, it has become completely acceptable. It's not even, you know, you don't even find Christians generally saying that this is not allowed. You don't even find Jews saying it's not allowed. Even though a few hundred years ago, it was their own priests and rabbis who, you know, were the most against it.
Okay, great. That's quite simple now. All right. Nicely put. Great question. Wonderful answer. We're going to go to the next one. Okay, you're asking the questions here on the Deen Show. Please keep sending them in. Okay, wow, good question here. Unique question. What is it about the woman that draws you to look at her as a magnet draws metal? Why is this? It's so hard, Shay. So I'm sure the men can.
This has obviously been asked by a young man who's just at the prime of his manhood, and he's saying, why is it that I never get satisfied with women, no matter how much I look at them? I want to look at them more and more.
Yeah, like what draws you to look at them? Why does something like pull you to look at her?
It's very simple, and that is that this is an innate feeling that men have for women, and also women have for men. And were it not for this feeling, humanity would cease to exist. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a natural urge in each gender to be attracted to the other. If it were not for that urge, marriage would not occur. Mm. Intimacy would not occur. Children would not be born. Think about it. If we didn't love that other person, why would we spend so much energy and money and sacrifice? And, you know, we change our whole lives to please our partners, you know? And then having children, You know, if we didn't have love for those children, the amount of stress that children give parents, the amount of money, the amount, why would we do that if it weren't for that love? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put that love in us, put that attraction in us, because that's the way we're going to survive as a species. So the way you're feeling towards women, my dear brother in Islam, is natural. What's unnatural is if you just let it just go all out. What you're feeling is natural.
Yes.
But the problem is, if you just say, you know what, I'm feeling it, I want to just take it all out and do whatever I want. No. Just like we have a feeling to eat and drink, but we keep it in check. We eat what's permitted and we avoid that which is impermitted. We eat in moderate quantities and we don't just splurge everything. Similarly, we have a desire for the opposite gender. Alhamdulillah, go for it. Get married. Find the spouse of your choice. And, you know, live a beautiful life. And be, you know, intimate with your spouse and do whatever you want with them. That's all permitted. But to go beyond that, that's where the transgression occurs.
Okay, good question. Great answer. Going on to the next question. You guys are asking them here on the Dean's show. Keep sending them in. Can I pray all my prayers before I start my day or when I get home since I'm busy earning a living during the day?
No, you can't. The short and simple answer, no, you can't. Not at all. Rather, as Allah says in the Quran, that إِنَّ صَلَاتَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا, that every single prayer, Allah has given it a very specific time. There is nothing that is more important than the prayer. Not your livelihood, not your sustenance. Rather, Allah says in the Quran that the believers are those men who their businesses don't distract them from the worship of Allah, from the prayer, from remembering Allah. This is a verse in the Quran. Believers are the men, you know, that they can control their desire for this world and their businesses and their fortunes. They say, you know what, it's time to pray, I'm going to go pray. I have to cut off from this world and just five minutes, say Allahu Akbar and stand in front of my Lord. When I say my salam, I go back to my world, no problem. But just for those timings, I have to get out of this world, inshallah, I'm in, and enter the real world, which is the world of the hereafter, the spirituality, the connection between you and Allah. The short answer is no. You have to pray every prayer at its proper time. Having said that, it is the mercy of Allah that every single prayer has a beginning and end time. There's a window. Remember, I mean, realize, if Allah had willed, He could have said, everybody has got to pray Dhuhr exactly at 12:52. Imagine if that were the case. Wherever we are in the world, exactly at that time, we would have just had to stop everything, go and pray. But Allah is merciful. He said, no, pray between X and Y timing. And generally, X and Y timing is 3, 4, 5 hours, sometimes 6, 7 hours, like between Maghrib, Fajr, and between Isha and Fajr, 6, 7 hours sometimes. Any time between these two timings, pray the prayer. So there's a window, and this is of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He's given us this window to pray in.
Okay, next question, and we'll try to get through these before we close. Is growing a beard fard?
Really, first and foremost, we have to prioritize that which is fard. Not all fard is the same. So when a brother comes and asks me, you know, is it obligatory for me to grow the beard? Firstly, I ask him back, are you praying 5 times a day, akhi? If he goes no, I say, worry about your prayer before you jump to the beard. Mm-hmm. You know, I ask him some simple questions. How's your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You know, because one of the problems is that you have this imam comes and he goes, everybody's got to grow their beard, and he gives a khutbah about the beard. But there are people sitting in that Jummah prayer, they never come to the mosque except for Jummah. They never pray to Allah except for that Jummah. Subhanallah, are you going to worry about the beard or worry about the 5 prayers? You know, so it's an issue of priorities. It's that you work your way up, you build your way up. If a person's involved, you know, drinking, you know, taking drugs, womanizing, you know, concern yourself with the beard. Make sure you be a better Muslim. If a person is cheating, stealing, lying, being a bad person, you know, you go priorities. Once a person has done all of that, then, you know, he comes to a stage where he's a good Muslim, he has a relationship with Allah. Now, he comes and he says, you know, well, you know, do I need to grow a beard or not? I say the classical opinion, you know, for the last 14 centuries has been that, yes, a man should show his manhood, you know, through the beard. This is something that the Prophet ﷺ wanted his followers to do, is to basically grow a beard. Now, what defines a beard? There's a huge difference of opinion. How big? How? Leave these differences. Just grow something called a beard. That's it. You know, don't worry about how long or short or tall or short. Just grow something called a beard. This is the majority opinion. There are a minority of scholars who have said that this is just a recommendation. It's not obligatory. But I personally lean towards the majority opinion, which is that really it is an obligation upon men to grow the beards. But remember, it is an obligation that is not as strong as many of the other obligations. So prioritize these obligations.
Okay, a lot of these questions were much longer, but for the sake of time, I try to shorten them. Is listening to music okay as long as there's no cursing in the songs?
Listening to music, I mean, this is something that, subhanAllah, in our times, you know, when you give the standard opinion, people find this strange. The standard opinion has been, throughout our history and the four schools of Sunni thought, has been that music is something that is prohibited in Islam. This has been the standard opinion. There have been probably three scholars in history, famous scholars, who have disagreed. And we have had tens of thousands of scholars of the Shafi'i and the Maliki and the Hanbali and the Hanafi Madhab. These are all famous schools of legal law in Islam. They all held the opinion that listening to music is something that should be avoided. When you hear this opinion now, people are like, what the heck, Islam prohibits music? I mean, come on, what type of religion is this, you know? Why could you do it? It's just, it, music makes me feel good. The reason is that, as Ibn Mas'ud said, and many of the famous scholars of the past said, that the heart is only like one vessel. It's only one fragile vessel. You can only fill it with the love of one thing. And if you fill it with the love of music, you're going to block it from the love of the Qur'an. That's what Ibn Mas'ud said. That if you love music, you're not going to love the Qur'an. And if you love the Qur'an, then you're not going to love music. And this is something that really and truly I know from experience, and I know a lot of people have told me this from their experiences as well. When you love hearing the Qur'an, and when you love to hear the speech of Allah being recited, and you're just entranced by it, when you hear music, your heart just crumbles. It feels weird. It shudders. You don't like it anymore. You just, it doesn't bring you the peace that the Qur'an brings you. Conversely, when you're addicted to music and you're totally into music, the Qur'an will not have much of an effect on you. You can listen to it one ear and out the other. It doesn't have any effect on you. And I've noticed this in my own life and in the life of many of the people who are close to me. Also, I want to point out that don't be so shallow. Do your research. There are many, many scientific research papers out there that have documented the effects of music on the human body. Of them is that it changes your palpitation, changes your heartbeat. Of them is that, you know, music of a certain rhythm will actually release certain, you know, hormones, certain chemicals that alter your, that's why music gives you a high. It's not just something that you feel, it's actually chemical. So the point being, when you attune your body to be affected by music, what you're doing is exactly what Ibn Mas'ud said, is that you're going to just cut it off from being attuned to the Qur'an. Okay? So it's not that simple. And there are many other ways to appreciate the beauty of Allah. It's not just through this thing. Appreciate it through nature. Appreciate it through this beauty, beautiful creation around you. You know, the stars and the trees and the, and you go travel in the land. Allah says, go sightsee. Go travel in the land. Go, you know, do other things that are permissible. So those of you who want to, like, you know, rest their souls and appreciate, you know, all of this beautiful creation of Allah, there are many ways to do so that doesn't involve that which might be harmful. And music is one of those things that really and truly, you know, if it's an either-or situation. If you love music, you're going to deprive yourself from the speech of Allah. If you love the speech of Allah, you have no need for the false highs that this thing known as music gives you.
For those
another point, music has always, historically, you know, and in the times we live in, always been associated with sex and interaction with the opposite gender and other haram. And that is why most music, look at A'udhu Billah, the music videos of our times. Look at how they basically, you know, what is the content? It's always about lust and extramarital and premarital sex. It's always about interaction of the opposite gender. Very rarely do you find a musician who actually has a higher goal in life. Look at the music videos and how they look at women and how they treat women in those. A'udhu Billah, disgusting. And now a person comes and says, yes, this is freeing my soul. Watching this filth and garbage of such, you know, nudity and evil talk and whatnot. This is the general rule of music. You can quote me exceptions, but these are exceptions that prove the rule. Music has always been associated, historically and in our times, with oppression of women. That's why you have music when you have females dancing around showing their bodies. Look at, is this feminization? Is this freedom of women or liberation? Or is it oppression? That's natural that music is associated with that. Likewise with making your passions flare up and being attracted to the opposite gender and doing things you don't want to do. Music does that. That's why to this day, you know, look where music is played. We're nightclubs, we're bars and disco, all of these places where fahisha, where evil is rampant. You don't find that taking place. You don't find, for example, that type of music being played in any serious gathering. Even of, you know, non-Muslims, you don't find that type of gathering where, you know, the president's going to come or a dignitary is going to come and that type of music is blaring in the background. You don't, do you? Because even they realize there's a time and place for that. And whether something serious, something of importance, that is not done. So this is something that, you know, historically has been the case and to this day. And of course, we don't need all of that. The Quran and Sunnah is quite clear on this. It's clear enough that the majority of the scholars, when I say the majority, I literally mean 99% of them.
Four schools of thoughts also.
Four schools of thought, all of them have concurred and have come to the conclusion that music should be avoided.
Well, and you mentioned, just for some of our viewers who don't know who Ibn Mas'ud is, can you?
Ibn Mas'ud is the famous companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Friend, companion of the
Prophet. He's one of the earliest converts to Islam. And he said that, you know, whoever has a love of music in his heart will not have a love of Quran. And there are many other, you know, instances of the companions when they pass by, music is being played, one of them put his hands in his ear and he said, I don't want to hear this stuff, you know, it's going to affect me, I don't want it to happen.
Yeah.
It's something that they understood. To this day, we all know, those of us who are into music, when you hear a tune, it brings back memories where you were before. You hear, yeah. When you, it's in your brain all the time, it's going around all the time, you memorize it. You're always thinking about it. You go to sleep and that tune is in your... Imagine, instead of that tune, if you had the Book of Allah.
Yes.
Imagine where you would go and what it would lead you to. So really, you know, it's something that we know from experience, that this is something that there's not good... No good comes out of this.
Okay, a couple more questions and we're going to come to a close. Is smoking cigarettes haram?
There's a general rule in Islam, and that is that you're asking all the controversial questions, by the way, Eddie. It's like every single controversial one. Let's just come out and ask him here, you know? Let's skip the particular one, okay? There's a general rule in Islam, and that is that anything that is harmful to the body would be prohibited. Anything that's harmful to the body. That's because Allah blessed you with this beautiful thing called life, okay? He blessed you with this body, with this, you know, this creation, this, you know, this life itself. For you to come and harm it intentionally is prohibited. Therefore, anything that would be deemed harmful, Sharia has completely prohibited it. In our time, once upon a time, the dangers of smoking were unknown to the scholars. Therefore, 100 years ago, smoking was considered to be, yeah, you should avoid it. Looks like you're wasting time, money doesn't look very good. But in our times, when the dangers of smoking are very clear, I mean, there is, you know, documented, and nobody denies this anymore, that smoking leads to lung cancer, you know, leads to this, leads to that. Nobody denies it. And that's why, you know, even in Western lands, when you buy a packet of cigarette from the government, you're told this, that product might possibly kill you. Don't buy it. The government tells you that. You know, you don't need a scholar to come and tell you. Don't waste your time, your money, your body doing things that's only going to cause you harm. Nowadays, the general opinion amongst the scholars is that smoking is prohibited.
Okay, last question, and we're going to come to a close. I pray, but I'm nervous to wear hijab because people, my friends and parents, will make fun of me. Will Allah forgive me as long as I pray? Is that a good excuse not to wear hijab?
Okay, and with that very last controversial question that you had, you just have to just, you know, put everything in there. Okay. This should be called the controversial Q&A session.
Okay.
Firstly, I'd like to congratulate the sister for at least getting the priority straight, and that is to get the prayer in. Okay, because once you have the prayer down, alhamdulillah, you've gone a far, far step forward. I'm not saying you've reached the conclusion, I'm not saying that's it, but I'm saying if you have the five prayers down, alhamdulillah, that's a very, very big thing, you know. Now it comes to the issue of hijab. The issue of hijab, realize that, I mean, I fully sympathize with the sisters of our times. It's something, it's a badge of honor and courage. I mean, any sister that I see wearing hijab, I have nothing but respect for her. Because she is showing her dedication to Islam 24/7. To me, she's showing her Islam more than any brother can. Because, you know, she's a woman, which means physically she's not as strong as a man. Emotionally, she's not as strong as a man. And yet, she has the courage and the audacity to proclaim to anybody who sees her, I am a Muslim and I'm proud of it. So any sister that does that, mashallah, you know, I have nothing but respect for her. Sisters who don't do that, I sympathize with them. I sympathize, I can't criticize. It's difficult. I don't know what I would do in that situation. But all I say is, sister, turn to Allah. Pray, make dua to Allah. Pray to Him to give you that courage that you need. And in the meantime, realize that if you can't wear that headscarf, at least try your best to wear loose clothing, you know, full sleeves, okay? Loose pants or loose skirts, even better. And interaction with the opposite gender should be very appropriate, and work up the courage. Don't just say, I'm either going to go all the way or just be as I am. Work up the courage bit by bit, you know. Maybe, for example, wear the scarf to the masjid every time you go. Every time you leave your house to masjid, wear the scarf. Anybody sees you in the scarf and the sister will say, MashaAllah, sister, you look very good. You know, maybe wear it, you know, to campus on Fridays and, you know, just make, say, tell yourself, this is a holy day. I have to be extra religious today. Okay? So work your way up. I'm not saying it's permissible not to wear the hijab the other days. Don't get me wrong. But what I am saying is, bit by bit, slowly but surely, you know, try to work your way up so that you reach the bare minimum level. And don't be scared of what the people are going to say about you, because in the end of the day, you know, as the saying goes, sticks and stones may, you know, I mean,
break my bones.
May break my bones, but you know, words cannot hurt me. No matter what they say about you, no matter what they talk, and realize any evil that they say about you, you're going to get reward for it. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise your rank because somebody criticized you and you were able to take that. And do it for the sake of Allah. So all I can advise you, sister, is pray to Allah and turn to Him and ask Him for the courage and support you need. And then give it a try. Don't be so scared. Give it a try. Perhaps the results will surprise you, inshallah. You know?
And this is the haq. This is the truth that He's telling us. And I'm very happy that you took up the challenge to answer some of these very,
controversial questions.
And please, I hope by Him, you know, trying to help us and He delivered the truth, that you are sincere enough to accept it. And I'd like to shake your hand, saying thank you, Jazakallah khairum. And also add one more thing to that. We're going to give you the new Deen Show t-shirt here.
Mashallah.
For you, Sheikh.
Jazakallah khair. I'll wear it with pride.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Jazakallah
and
khair.
I'd like to thank everyone. I encourage you to continue sending us your emails, your questions, so when I get another opportunity to sit down with one of our guests who has the credentials, not a car mechanic or an engineer, but a doctor in this field, someone who's qualified to give us these answers, keep sending them in. And like we learned today, let's spend more time getting to know the book of our Creator, the verbatim word of God, Allah, and I think we'll be better off in the long run. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you.